Katy Manning, welcome. How lovely to see you.
I love the way we start this. We've been talking for 3 hours.
Yeah.
And we've been saying all these things that I said, thank you, there's not a camera on that.
I suddenly realised it's you. Yes, Katy Manning.
How lovely to meet you.
So, welcome to Liverpool.
Oh, thank you.
Not the first time, I believe.
No, I forgot that it wasn't the first time.
Okay, when was the first time, roughly?
I don't do years, darling, because it sort of doesn't matter, does it? It was back then, and it was a sort of 70s time.
Okay.
And I was at the Liverpool Playhouse, and I did French Without Tears.
Okay.
In which I was probably appalling, but I had a lovely time here.
What was your role, do you recall?
I think I was supposed to be playing the sort of bitch, but I was very, very young, and it just didn't quite pan out.
Okay.
And I had a lovely cast, I had a lovely time. And I've done a couple of conventions here, but with conventions you just kind of go in and go out.
Yeah, of course. You know. You're here with a very special show, and I was surprised to hear...
I was just wondering why I was here.
I believe it's a one-off. I assumed it was a tour, but it's a one-off.
No. This is it.
This is one night only.
I love that. This is it. You should never say never.
No, of course.
But I'm saying never in the moment of my life could I ever imagine doing this again. Well, I mean, if it wasn't for George, who was... It must be the first time an actress has ever, and as my agent pointed out, said, could you send him an email and ask him why on earth he wants me?
Now, George is St. George of St. George's Hall. Right.
Who's absolutely lovely and been adorable and hasn't let me get off the hook once, even when I was saying, no, maybe, you know, if you can only get 50 people, there's no point in me doing it, we've called it quits.
Yeah.
But no, I'm here and it is the most beautiful place. It's extraordinary.
Isn't it, Jess? Liverpool and St. George's Hall.
Well, Liverpool...
But what is the show? What is it?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know?
No.
It's never been
I'll
done
find
before.
Out tonight.
It's never going to be done again.
No, because I don't know what I'm going to do, so it can't be done again, can it?
Right. Is this how you like to work?
It's the only way I know how.
Yeah.
I mean, unless you've got a script and a play and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
I mean, basically...
Very overrated, those plays and scripts.
But also, I know you're terrible, darling, aren't they? Ghastly things. But what it is when you think about... I don't actually walk around thinking about my life.
Right.
You know, it sounds very Chekhovian, doesn't it? Yeah. I'm thinking about my life. Yeah. No, it's because if you live life in the moment, which I always call it living in the O between the N and the W... You know, because that's the only place you can be. Mm. You know, and everything that's gone, you kind of let it go.
Mm. Well, speaking of your life, I want to take you right back to the very, very
start. Is that what we were discussing?
You're telling me that you can't remember anything, but I'm going to push my luck and
ask, I can.
What's your very earliest memory on this planet?
I think my earliest memory was when we were supposed to be going to the circus. Now, they didn't know that I couldn't see. I had about 5 years on this planet where I thought everything was whatever, you know, like everything was like a French impressionist painting to me. And, you know, I didn't even recognize my own mother from a distance. I mean, I tell a story, which is true, in Not a Well Woman, where I'd been on a train with my father and I came back. And I jumped off the train. I was so excited to see my mummy. And I ran up and I went, Mummy, 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 I've missed you so much, Mummy. And this voice turned around and said, No, darling, I don't think so. You know, because as I say, when you can't see, anyone can be your mummy.
So what was wrong with your vision?
I was born partially sighted.
Right.
And, but until they didn't know, because with a child, I don't know whether you know, children do things very close. And I lived very much in this little world of mine. The only thing I remember is we were going to go to the circus and my parents got me all excited because I hadn't been to a circus ever in my life. Now I'm glad I haven't. I'll never go again. And I ran to go and and I smashed my head onto the corner of the table. And I had to have 7 stitches in my head.
Oh.
And I never got to go to the circus.
Right.
So for a whole year. And then the following year, I went to go to the circus. And I didn't notice, but there was this clown coming towards me. And he had a great big comb. And he started combing my hair with a great big comb. And I thought, and I started to cry. That's it. I'm never going to the circus again. That's the worst first memory anybody's ever had. But that honestly is my first memory.
How would you describe yourself as a child? And did you take to school when the day came?
Well, once again, when you can't see, I was terribly, terribly shy. in the sense that I think it was all to do with sight, in all honesty. And I was very good at voices very young, you know, because sound was my friend. I loved sounds, I still do. I drive everybody nuts because I'm always making lots of noises.
Your dad, that's an interesting history with your father. He was a writer and so much more.
Well, yes, he was. He was a fascinating, feisty, but fascinating man who loved to party and dance. But he started out in politics. Daddy's whole thing with politics was common sense. You know it makes sense. And common sense really is what life is, you know, what those things are all about.
And common sense was in politics. This must be a long time ago.
This was the 50s, but no. He also was looking at women getting back into the workplace after they'd had children and crushes. He was very strongly, when he took over as chairman of the press club, he got it out of a massive debt. And then he was absolutely furious that women were not a part of this elite gentleman's club. And so the doors were open to women. He fought against apartheid in sport. He changed the rules of boxing so that there was a doctor at the side of the ring, so that it was, you know, that it was never just somebody massacring, you know, each other, and that it remained a sport. He fought for safer terraces in football. He got pensions for journalists, wives, husbands, partners. He was a campaigner. He was a writer of wrongs. He had a vorpal sword in hand. And so I grew up with all this around me as a child. And the most fascinating, you know, very long dinner parties. You know, as a child, we'd have 5-6 hour dinner parties. And there'd be historians and politicians, and we'd have cricket teams in, and we'd have boxers and parties going on till 6 o'clock in the morning.
How did they take to you at school?
I didn't fit in frightfully.
I was thinking.
I was a little dancer, and I liked doing art, and I adored writing poetry, and I was very good at stories. Frightful at sport. And they gave me a detention because they said I was deliberately not catching the ball, or, you know. And eventually one of the teachers said, I think we better take you out of all sporting things. And she very sweetly, I got to play Alice in Wonderland. And, you know, I got to start acting. But that never crossed my mind.
Turning 13. I assume you turned 13 at some point.
I was taken out of school by...
Did you rebel? I mean, were you...
No, no? But Daddy realised that school wasn't the place for me, and I was a little... I loved dancing, and because you don't need to see when you dance. It was wonderful. And I was voted class captain, and it was the first time they'd ever turned down a vote. And my father said, well, that's it. Because they said that I was too naughty and too chatty. And, right. You know, so that was that. I suddenly said I wanted to go to boarding school. And so my father got me an interview for Wadhurst College, and I had to write an essay. And I wrote an essay called London at Night. Well, they decided I wasn't suitable for Wadhurst Ladies College.
Because of what you put in?
Well, I knew about London at Night. I mean, Daddy, Mummy, we used to be in the car, you know, waiting for Daddy to come out of Langham House with the BBC or, you know, out of the press club or somewhere. So I knew what London at Night was.
You mentioned Alice. You played Alice in Wonderland. Were there any other school productions?
I played Bashful in Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
All right. What did you bring to the role, can you recall?
A very, very wonderfully knitted pom-pom hat that was... I loved it. I absolutely loved doing that. And so eventually I went to Dixon and Wolfe Tutorial School, which was in Victoria. And it was... and there was only about 9 students. And they were all kind of titled. And I turned up in my duffel coat with my Band the Bomb badge. Because I thought that was, like, cool.
Uh-huh. It is.
And that's when my first very, very best friend started, because that's where I met Liza.
Now, when you say Liza...
It's Liza with a Z, not Liza with a S.
Well, how did that come about? So she was there, you were there...
We were both misfits.
Yeah.
We both really weren't right for even that.
Right.
And Liza and I really did look like misfits. She's there in a little plaid skirt, and I'm there in my knee socks and my Band the Bomb badge and duffel coat, and my huge... Because by this time, they'd realised I couldn't see. and I was wearing these massive
goggles. Yes.
And Liza and I just were, and we just sort of, I discovered that Father Christmas didn't exist.
Really?
Yeah.
When?
Very late in life.
Says who?
And when I found out that he didn't exist, I just went on to boys. I went from Father Christmas,
To boys.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah. But the trouble was, boys didn't think I was very interesting.
Huh.
Do you know, we played Postman's Knock.
Yeah.
And all the, you know, you go outside and you get kissed. They wouldn't go outside and kiss me because I wore funny glasses.
Which boys were these?
Any boys.
Can we name and shame
them now?
Do you
know, Liza and I used to sit there in St. James's Park, you know, and hoping that boys would come and talk to us.
Really?
Ignored us. And we tried barring up Mama's shoes, and we tried everything. We tried smoking.
So your life was, it started off interesting. It's become
didn't get
even
much better.
More, so
no.
Just you're hanging out with some of the most interesting people on the planet, perhaps.
But I'm saying,
Judy, but is this the norm for you? It's the norm for you.
It's just norm. So, I'd had all these sports people and stuff like that, and I didn't
know. You mentioned Noel Coward before as well.
Yes, we had Mama. We were staying at the Savoy. This was when Judy was still married, Sid Love. And Noel Coward was there and, you know, invited us in for tea and sandwiches. You know, and I sort of went, we were there, and there was one tiny chocolate eclair left on the plate. And I know it was Noel Coward, but at that age, you know, 10, 11, whatever it was, you know, and I wasn't a person like nowadays. People are much more aware of stars and meeting great people. It was just people to me. And all Liza and I could think about would it be rude to have the last chocolate eclair? Now, at the age, you know, now you think, oh my God, I met, you know. But then that chocolate eclair was more important.
Yeah.
You know, even though I've subsequently done his plays and I worship his work. Yeah. But there is no awareness. It just is what your life is.
What ambitions did you have by this?
None.
None. No ambitions whatsoever.
I'd love to be one of these people say, oh yes, I've always wanted to be an actress.
Yeah.
No.
Well, you say you had no plan.
No
so
plan.
On leaving, did you have an agent when you left school? I mean,
no.
How did... No. So
I had a car accident. I spent 2 years in hospital. I didn't bother. You know, that was... You see, you can't be anywhere else but in the moment.
No, I agree.
You know, because I suddenly only had... I had half my face up here, you know.
Really?
Oh,
was
yes.
That bad an accident?
Yes. Uh-huh. I mean, oh, yeah, this has all been... This was all separated and it's all been rebuilt. And when you kiss me on the... cheek.
Yes.
It came from there.
Oh, really?
So the expression kiss my ass.
Oh, right.
So, because all this, So I had all that to deal with.
But suddenly, you reached the man at the top.
Ah, but you see, so that was all
that
very
happen,
serendipitous.
Ah.
Basically, what happened was I went to America, and where my sister was this stunning top model. Mm. And I was at one of her parties, and this chap was there, and he flew my parents out from England. They wanted me to sign a 5-year contract with MGM. And Daddy said, well, you know, if you want to do it, darling, you know, go ahead, because I had to have parental. And he said, but, you know, if you sign a contract like that, you're with them for 5 years. Mm. And, you know, whether you make one film or no film. I hadn't thought about films. Anyway, so I didn't do that in the end. I came back and I thought, you know what? Stuff it. I'm going to go and I'm going to audition. And any the first drama school that takes me gets me. Mm. So Webber Douglas got me.
Okay.
And that was that. And I came straight out of that and I got 5 lines as a French au pair girl because my only greatest gift in life was I spoke French.
And this was in Man at the Top, which was a...
Yeah, which was groundbreaking television. I mean,
popular TV series, yeah, yeah.
And anyway, I was doing it, and Kenneth Hague and the producers, I mean, suddenly took me out. I thought, God, I've got sacked already. And they gave me the Juve lead. Mm. And then John Brain loved what I did with the character. I was playing a very naughty 16-year-old. They wrote another one for me, and then while I was doing that, I got I went to audition for Doctor Who. Mm. They'd already shortlisted it to three. Mm. And I just, because I was doing this show and this other thing, and they decided to go with me. So it was all very random, because I was late for the auditions because I was doing something else.
Were you aware of the series of Doctor Who at that time?
Oh, yeah, I'd watched it.
You'd watched it?
Yeah, I loved it.
You had to audition for the part of
Well,
Joe?
No, because
they knew who you were.
They'd shortlisted it down to like three people. Mm. Nobody knew. I didn't know who I was. Mm. And they'd shortlisted it. And so when I went there, they said, could you read from the script? So I went, no. So they said, oh, well, would you improvise? Mm. I said, oh, yeah, I can do that. Mm. So I did a whole huge improvisation with like a hat on a hat stand, and you know, it had to turn into a devil, and then it was had to be a hat again. And
so nothing related to Doctor Who?
No,
as such,
nothing
no.
at okay. all.
Uh-huh. Well, was it an instant fit? I mean, you're going into what it was a long-running series. It had been
Television Centre then was the most exciting. Mm. And it gave you all this energy because there was all these creative people around. And we didn't have all those things that stopped us then that we do now. You know, and we were all naughty and we all party, whatever, but everybody got their job done. Everybody was creative. And we were all so focused. And you got Barry Letts came in and he really started to take the, you know, a bit like when Russell T came in and mm-hmm. took over and he brought it right back up to where it should be. You know, John and I arrived somewhere in a helicopter and there's this a sea of faces and I went, oh, you know, what's happening? And he said, I think we might be successful, dear girl. And, you know, so suddenly there it was. It was beginning to happen. And I was in it because I was great for the young kids, because you must never forget that Doctor Who must have that basic thing for children. Yeah. Never, ever forget them. Don't just suddenly turn it into a grown-up. And then it had teenagers, and then it got the cult thing. And then, I don't know, Barry Letts said it was due. He also put me in it because the fathers started to stay in after the football results to see the miniskirts.
How would you describe Joe Grant?
I think Joe was quite often misunderstood and in people's memories because of the miniskirts. Hmm. And they'd say, oh, she was a screaming. Jo hardly ever screamed. She was unbelievably brave. She was like 18, 19 years old. You know, I love the fact that when he said, you know, she said, well, I did this, I did maths, I did science. And then she asked a question one day and he said, well, I thought you did maths and science. And she said, I never said I passed. And I think that said a lot about Jo straight away. But she was gutsy. Yeah. And she actually offered her life on several occasions. You know, that the doctor was more important, and she realised his work was more important than her life. And climbing mountains in miniskirts and platform shoes, that's a brave woman, uh-huh. you know, with eyelashes that would knot together so that, you know, couldn't see. I couldn't see then, I didn't have contact lenses. So that's why John was amazing. He used to constantly be standing at the edge of a cliff doing this, because he said, she'll go over, she will, because she won't stop, she'll just keep running. And he was wonderful to me. From day one, we clicked.
Really? You had the opportunity to reprise the role of Joe after quite a few years, a short while back. How had she changed?
You've got to keep the essence of the person, because I guess I'm the essence of what I was back then, as you are.
Mm,
you know,
very much so.
You know, unless something really has happened to change you. And still married to her beloved professor, who she always felt was the closest she could ever get to the young doctor, and that they were still saving this planet and all the amazing things that she'd done. And I thought, well, she'd still be a very energetic older woman. And she always had a big heart, Jo. She was a great, very loving character. And I think it was beautifully written. It was a joy to do. Matt Smith was such a generous, creative, wonderful young actor.
Why did you decide to leave the safety of a very regular acting job?
I think you just said the word. You just answered your own question.
Safety.
There you go, you said it.
The danger, danger, red alert.
Well, it also, you know, when you've done so, I do think for the people watching, if I put my director's, producer's hat on, that if you see somebody like the doctor and you see him with there are going to be certain ways he'll always react with this particular personality of this particular assistant. Is that so? What's nice is when you bring in a new person, a new assistant, you can see him reacting in a different way, which then puts a different level onto the show. And I think that after 3 years, that was a good idea. She says, pouring her water in her ear.
So you went straight into Target, if I remember, with Patrick Maher and.
Well, this might become apparent tonight in some of my footage. People who said you type, because you know you do. People have complained that they've been typecast.
No, you weren't, were you?
No, because Douglas Canfield, another of the children's godparents, 12 we have, immediately said, "I think you're a very, very good straight actress, and I think that you excel in these areas." And anyway, so he cast me as a junkie, and then the first lesbian on British television. Cheers.
Down the years, people have said there should be a female doctor. Would you do it?
It's written for a man.
You think?
And that is just one of those things that people have to say, because that's the era that we live in, and we, well, don't take me down that road.
Okay, I won't.
All I can say is it's a part beautifully written for a man in the same way as there are parts that are beautifully written for women. And I think that that's how it should be. That doesn't mean that Missy isn't perfect, and that, you know, Lethbridge-Stewart, all those characters, perfect. Doctor Who is written for a man.
I said that was my final question. Of course, it wasn't. You're back in the UK now. What's next for Katy Manning?
This show tonight,
and then?
I haven't gone any further in my head. There are other things, but I'm not going to focus on them until they get close.
So anything
like
could happen.
Like next week, there's gigs booked in, but I won't think about it until I'm about to do it.
Anything could happen in the next half hour with Katy Manning.
Listen, if you leave the room in your life for things to happen and stop constantly planning and, you know, making, it's amazing what magic can happen if you just go with the flow, live in the now. It's all we got.
Katy,
this could be the last thing we ever do.
It could.
I could walk out of here now and go under a bus.
Well, please don't.
It would be with Harry Smile time if I did.
This has been a magical afternoon for me. Thank you.
Thank
from
you.
The bottom of my heart. Absolute joy. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much.